Hello and welcome back to a new video here in my DirectX 12 video series on YouTube. Today we're going to talk about the GPU rendering pipeline in DirectX 12. Actually, we're just talking about the general theory, not how it is implemented with descriptors in DirectX 12 and how to actually compile pipeline states, so-called. We will only talk about the theory and how it is arranged, not the details. We have to do some work today, but I want to explain it, and actually not only explaining it, but also telling you why that is and why that is required, so that the pipeline feels natural to you. I always complained about, when I learned DirectX 11 back then, that it was so unnatural. What is a tessellator? What it is doing? What is the pixel shader? Why do we need a pixel in the vertex shader? Why don't we do this all in one shader? It was not very well explained back then. I mean, there were only a few sources and they were mostly focused on just rushing in the code so that you can actually draw something and you could actually accept it and later on learning things while experimenting, but I personally do more like that people tell you why that is and kind of like do it in a lecture way, not doing it kind of like the here's my example code and you copy paste it. So this is kind of like more a lecture than a kind of like stupid tutorial. So yeah, it's a bit of heavy work to do the next videos, but if we are done with this section, we will be ready for basic drawing, and after that we will go into UI, 2D and 3D stuff. So, stay tuned. Alright, let us start with a short puzzle for the beginning. And the puzzle is actually a search image, and you can actually see that there is something missing down here. And the question is, what is missing? Before we come to the solution to that question, I want to explain you what is currently in this image. First of all, we have the CPU. And we have already learned how to interface with the GPU, how to queue and execute comment lists and use a comment queue, how to synchronize between comment queues, how to synchronize CPU and GPU. And we have learned how to allocate memory on the GPU. We have learned how to copy data to the GPU. And also, even though we've not done it explicitly, but we know the theory because it just works like copying to the GPU, reading back data from the GPU. We also have created a back buffer and a swap chain, and we also learned how to present an image to the screen, which is currently completely black. Well, actually it's quite obvious what is missing here. It is actually the data on the back buffer, because, well, the back buffer is just black, and, well, it's not quite interesting to look at a black back buffer. So yeah, there is the thing which is missing. It is drawing. We want to draw data on the GPU, and drawing is done with a program which is running on the GPU. A program on the GPU is called shader, so a shader running on the GPU is responsible for drawing. Well, actually not only the shader, also the... the configuration of the whole pipeline, but we will come back to this in a few slides. So, our goal is drawing on a GPU. It is still a way to go, but our goal is inside, and this is actually the thing which I hope will keep you watching these videos, even though they will be heavily theory-based. I hope that the goal of finally drawing something and deeply understanding the pipeline is enough for you to watch it. Before we actually start into investigating the pipeline, I want to take a comparison between current GPUs or modern GPUs and old GPUs. First of all, I want to start with current GPUs. Why? Because we have already talked about how a GPU is built. We have taken a look at the insights of RTX 3090. So we can actually recall the knowledge of that video and see what the main content of the GPU is. The main content or main building block of the GPU are the programmable cores, which also means that the GPU is programmable, or that the heavy work is done by programming the GPU, which is also right. We are programming the GPU with shaders, and even modern GPUs have special configurable renderer hardware, for example the rasterizer, texture units, or in the Nvidia case, ray tracing cores. You have some fixed function hardware you cannot fully control. Of course, you can configure it. So you kind of like say, hey, rasterizer, you need to work that way. Hey, output merger, you need to work that way. And then the output merger will do what you want, but you cannot say, hey, output merger, what are your input data? Run my program with your input parameters and I give you your output parameters. This is programmable. While configurable is, hey, do that in that case, or not do that in that case, but from your options you can do with that, do that, for example. By having a modern game GPU, which mostly has programmable cores, it also means that it is universally usable. So for example, compute task. You can take a modern GPU and do non-rendering stuff at all. You can just tell it to do some heavy compute work. For example, computing the Fibonacci number. Okay, this is a quite recursive algorithm, but you could do this in several kind of like recursive sum up kernels. But yeah, it would be possible to do it on a GPU. Yeah, I think it would also be quite fast. It would be interesting to see it on a GPU. I probably think that in the CUDA toolkit there will be a Fibonacci thing in there. So yeah, but that's off topic. So let's compare to the old GPU. What was an old GPU? An old GPU was, at the start, when GPUs came to the market, were only fixed functions. So the GPU just had some configuration values you could give it, and you gave it input data and it produces pixel. So as you can see, you had input data, which goes in, and output data, which goes out. And during that way, you could give it options to do. So you can imagine it like a pipeline. You put in data at the top of the pipeline, and at the bottom of the pipeline, the pixels fall out, kind of like. And kind of like every pipeline step is kind of like a process, which you could configure from, let's say, from the left. So you put in configuration from the left, data from above, and it flows to the bottom and gives you your final pixels at the bottom. Later on, when the technology evolved, you would actually take several stages of these pipelined GPUs and remove them and put in programmable stages. We will see them later, which were fully programmable. So the GPU got its own processor, and you could then add own code to the GPU, which was executed for data that the previously pipeline steps has processed and are, after the computation inside of your program, inside of your shader is done, returned to the next pipeline object state. Stage. Well, but this actually also means that at the start, and also later on, GPUs were not universally usable, because they were mainly built inside of the graphic pipelines, and things couldn't be used outside of this graphic pipeline. Of course, you could draw something, kind of like a final result inside of a texture, and load the texture back to the CPU, or at least as soon as the GPU supported backloading, load it back to the CPU, read it back, and then interpret this data and use it also on the GPU side as general compute. But today it's much easier, and you remove all the overhead of the rasterizing steps and all the other fixed function pipeline states that you are not using on a general compute task by just using kind of like the cores of the GPU. But yeah, we're gonna talk about this later again. So because the old GPUs were built as a pipeline, it is actually, until today, still common to do, or not common, or still architectured like this. It's still a pipeline. So if you take a look at the DirectX 12 pipeline, well, okay, I know that image is quite overwhelming, but yeah, we will come back to this and take it apart step by step. So actually, first of all, forget all that stuff here. We are not gonna talk about that in this video. We're gonna talk about this in the next video. So forget everything which is here. We only care about that. So first of all, what is the actual pipeline? The pipeline is that black box here. So that is the pipeline. Starting at the input assembler, over the tessellator, over the rasterizer, out to the output merger. This is the DirectX 12 pipeline. It has some things which are working or are required to, in according to the pipeline, which is these views, and these views. These are required for using the pipeline, or not required, but required when you want to interact with that pipeline in a specific way. First of all, we're gonna start by explaining the most basic things. This actually also involved these views, these vertex buffer views and render target views, but we will come back to this later, even though we are indirectly working with them now. But we're going to talk about them later. So first of all, the important things or the required things if you want to draw data, even through DirectX only flags the vertex shader as required. It is still required if you want to really draw some data or really create a simple game, then all everything I marked here is required. And actually with these marked stages, you can create a full game. But it may not be the best game, because in terms of visual. So first of all, let me take a step back and tell you what is programmable and what is a fixed function. First of all, everything which is blue, so dark blue and light blue, is programmable. So these are all shaders, programs that you write. And everything which is purple here are fixed function states, which are configurable but not programmable. We're going to take a look at the input assembler, vertex shader, rasterizer, pixel shader, and output merger for start. First of all, we're going to take this whole pipeline and put it apart because I want to explain how we get to this step by step. So we will do a little derivation of the pipeline. Why do we need vertex and pixel shaders, and also what does this fixed function hardware in between does? So first of all, what is our goal, our target? What do we want to create? What did you imagine when you said, okay, I want to start DirectX programming? What image do you had in mind? Well, actually, to admit, I had something in mind like this. Well, okay, it's a bit more modern because I want something visual nice. So I want some visual rich image here. So it's an image from Shadow of the Tomb Raider. When I started programming DirectX 11 back then in the days, I had in mind kind of like Minecraft, Roller Coaster Tycoon and all that stuff. But yeah, the most people who are getting into rendering now do have games like Tomb Raider or... Well, okay, I will not say this game name because I hate this game totally. It starts with F and ends with Knight. Or Knight, not Knight. So yeah. You probably know what I mean. I hate this game. You imagine a game like that. So you want to do some fancy mountains in the back. You want to have some semi-transparent leaves here. You want to draw a fancy wall with tessellation and displacement mapping. You want to draw fancy and rich characters. You want to draw flowing water. You want to draw some UI over people so that your player can see, oh, I can interact with that guy. So you want to do really much. But well, I also had that in mind when I started programming. I sadly cannot tell you that you will be there with the end of that tutorial. Because first of all, it is much more involved to write an engine that does all that stuff. I have made many simplifications in our rendering framework, which were not tolerant if you want to do it in a game engine context. Okay, even though many game engines have been ported to DirectX 12 and still do it in the DirectX 11 way, but with the DirectX 12 API. But if you design a DirectX 12 engine today, you have to do so many more things than what we did. So yeah, we will not be technically there at the end of the tutorial and also visually. Because sadly, really sadly, I'm not an artist. Well, I have tried it many times. I can work with programs like Blender, Photoshop. I know how they technically work. And I can archive technically some things, but I'm not skilled enough in terms of drawing and anatomy and modeling to actually do some really nice things like that. I don't think I would be able to do that wall. So yeah, but maybe as soon as my engine is done, I maybe do that. I don't know, but I probably find some people who are keen on modeling. But modeling is quite hard. So yeah, for me at least. For other people, the programming thing is hard and the modeling is easy. So yeah, but well, we're not gonna achieve that. So let's do some simplifications here and add a simple example here. So yeah, that's what we are gonna archive with the tutorial series. Okay, we are doing more, but for now, for all the derivation stuff I'm doing now, this should be sufficient and enough. So first of all, some primitive shapes. Actually, the circle is a bit more involved than the triangle and the box up there. Also, the lion is more involved because lines are normally not drawn as lines, like we are gonna explain it here. But this will be all done in the UI video. So let's go on. So to actually draw data, we need to define geometry. And at best, we want to define a universal model with that we can describe any geometry imaginable. Because, well, we need kind of like data that is put on top of the GPU pipeline and can be processed through all the stages we have seen and finally be outputted as pixels. So we need a data type which can flow through the GPU. First of all, what you may think about is a pixel. Let's do it with a pixel. It could be okay. We're gonna take a look and how things would work out with a pixel later on. But let's just continue on the work. We may then abstract the pixel into a point and say, okay, let's not just define a scale pixel. Let's define a non-scale point, because a point difference between pixel is defined of the specific size of your pixel size monitor. And a point is by definition infinitesimal small. It just has a position, but it is infinitesimal small. So you could interpret it as big that it covers the whole screen, or you could interpret it as small that it is not covering anything at all. Next step, when we have defined a point, is obviously a line, because, well, take two points and draw a line between them, you have a line. Or, yeah, a line. Next step, triangle. Take another point to that line and you have a triangle. Take another point to that triangle and we have a quad. Take some more points and we got an octagon. Take some points of a specific order and we have a polygon. So as you can see, everything is evolved around points. Or better to say, edges, or as we're gonna tell them, vertices, singular vertex. So we will now start by calling every, like, not point, but every edge vertex. And another observation, which is important for the next things to understand, is that a vertex does not only describe a position, but it describes data. Actually, you don't even need to describe a position at all with a vertex. You can, and you at some point have to, because at some point you need to define a position. But as an input argument for the input assembler, you don't need to define a vertex with a position. It can be of arbitrary data. So coordinates, colors, positions, normals, whatever you want, indexes, whatever. It's just important that you see that a vertex is just a collection of data. And now that we have defined a vertex, we actually need to define a space where a vertex can, as soon as it gets a position, be placed on. And this is the so-called display space. First of all, what's the problem with displays, monitors? Everyone has a different monitor, okay? There are some kind of like generic monitors, which many people have, but as a game engine programmer or a graphic programmer, you need to keep in mind that everybody, in a worst case, has a different monitor that is using applications. So we kind of like need to define what is the difference between monitors. First of all, every monitor has a different color space, for example, HDR and not HDR monitors, but this is actually not the thing which is a problem here, because this has more something to do with the color and the drawing on the GPU. But every monitor you find in the world can have a different resolution, so a different width height, a different DPI, a different monitor screen resolution, a different ratio. There are 4 to 3 monitors, 16 to 9. And also widescreen monitors, which may be curved. So actually, curved doesn't bother us, because this is just how the monitor is physically built, but it has a different ratio and have a different resolution. And this is actually the problem. We could start at the top left corner of every monitor and define it as 0, 0, and the bottom right as pixel width times pixel height. But this would not be universally usable. So we need to actually manually calculate the values for every monitor resolution on load up, and this is actually bad. So actually, to overcome that, we have defined a new coordinate system, a normalized device coordinate it is called, or also sometimes referred as normalized device space. The difference between space and coordinates is that coordinates actually are the coordinates inside the screen, and space actually means an object transformed so that it matches the display. This kind of like the difference here. It is a bit hard to understand or to differentiate between them or to use them right. It takes a bit of practice, and actually just for you to remind, an NDC and NDS kind of like is the same in big parentheses. So yeah, now that we have this space, we need to define actually geometry in this space. And this is actually done in relation to that NDS space. So you define it on the unit width. So one is actually a scale, which is relating to some value you have chosen. For example, if you are doing a game, often it is done in meters. So the NDS is referred to as, let's say, the display then would have 2 times 2 meters. Even though this is not theoretically right, but it is just a unit definition which you then need to transform the geometry into the actual position so that it makes sense in sense of the camera and the position of your character in the world. So there is some transformation required, but you always define things in that kind of like NDS reference scale. Because if you will not do this, you would have inconsistency and, well, maybe the character is the same size as a cup because there was no reference scale when modeling the objects. Something that is really important, models are not created in the NDS space, they are created in the object space, which is kind of similar to the NDS space, but NDS is the display space, which is actually two-dimensional, and the object space is three-dimensional, and you actually need a mapping from that three-dimensional object space to that two-dimensional display space. Well, of course, the display still has a depth value or a third coordinate associated with it, but this is actually used and interpreted in a different way than you might think. So yeah, how would it look like if you define a triangle and a quad here? So here you can see a quad. Oh, actually, I forgot to change the German text here. This is just a quad and this is a triangle, so sorry for that. And for example, the quad is just defined from -1, -1 to 1, 1. And the triangle is defined from -1, 1 to 1, 1. From -1, -1 to 0, 1 and 1, -1, which is just into that reference of the display. And as you can see, of course, there's some transformation required because, well, if you would leave it like it is, it would just cover up the whole screen, and this is not what we want. So let's talk about the first primitive I have shown you in the list and the previous slides. It is the pixel. Nice thing on the pixel is it is equivalent to the physical target, so it directly maps. We don't have to take any special considerations, we don't have to rasterize things, we also already have all data available in pixel, and we can just straightforward draw them. One problem with pixels is it is binary, so we get some clipping and aliasing with that. Aliasing is when you have kind of like a stair pattern here. You can see that these pixels here, even though this should represent a triangle, has in kind of pixels a stair pattern here on the left and right side, because the pixels are not aligned in the same kind of like angle the edge of the triangle is aligned. And this is actually called aliasing. We still have this problem when you have different primitives, but different primitives allow us to do something called multi-sample anti-aliasing, which pixels would not allow us to do. Next thing with pixels is it is not good for geometry, because you would always need to define a volumetric grid and set every pixel that is occupied by that object, and this is really bad. And the next thing, it's not scalable, because, well, of course you could double it, but it would then be very blocky and it would not scale dynamically, because when you scale it with blocks, you are kind of like Minecraft. If you building a thing in Minecraft the double of the size, it is the double of the size, but it is still in the Minecraft reference size and it hasn't any different positions. Of course, in Minecraft you could add several blocks For example, in the diagonal wall, you could add some blocks that it looks more diagonal, but when you're just doubling it, it is not doing that. So yeah, it is not scaling very well, or if you want to scale it, you need to apply some complex algorithms to actually interpolate and set several other pixels, so it's not very well. But it is, in any case, our target format. The target that we want to archive is a pixel. But how do we get the pixel? For example, if we now abstract this pixel to the point. So we define a point by a vertex. So important, as I already told you, a point is not a pixel. So this vertex is now defined by a x and a y coordinate here. And it is required to actually map this to a pixel. And so, because we are away from the pixel data type, we need some software or hardware what is doing that. And this is actually the rasterizer. It's a fixed function hardware part of the GPU pipeline, which takes in, for example, here in this case, a vertex and the information that we are currently drawing points. And it can then generate of the x and y coordinates, of course, in NDS. The can then generate a pixel out of it. So a pixel with the coordinates SX and SY in this case. Nice thing on a pixel, it can be scaled. If you scale a pixel, well, it nothing happens because a pixel is infinitesimally small, which also means it can be scaled, even through scaling is completely nonsense. But you can scale it in terms of positions. But you can actually use it for transformation with positions because it will not clip to the next pixel location. You can freely move it. And the nice thing is you can actually also interpret it like you want. A pixel is not interpretable. A pixel just says, hey, I'm a pixel, I'm that pixel. A point, you could use it and say, hey, I am no pixel, or hey, I'm a collection of that pixels. Also, quite nice, it can be scaled and used like you want. Next thing, a pixel doesn't Next thing, a point doesn't require any computations at all, would be wrong, but low computation, because, well, it just has the data which is assigned with that single vertex, and it is the same among all pixels that this single point is covering. But still not good for geometry. We still have a pixel and we still would need a grid to put in points, even though they are now infinitesimally small, but, well, they are still actually pixels, if you would want to see it like that. Or geometry splats, sometimes also called. So now let's take two points and create a line off of them. So a line actually is defined by two points, or better to say two vertices. So in case here we have two points, the point A and the point B, also defined by their coordinates, which are put inside of the rasterizer, which now, which is very important, generates none or up to many pixels. So even though you only have a maximum of two points as the inputs, or two vertices as the inputs, you still can get many pixels out of that. Because, well, if you take in here the pixel A, the point A and the point B and draw the line, we can actually see that here a third pixel is also on that line. Now we kind of like have a problem. Because I told you a vertex is a collection of data. And we need to map this data to every pixel. But now, for example, here, this middle pixel is dependent of the pixel A and B. So we kind of like need the middle of the data of both. So we need to calculate new data, new pixel data, based on that vertex data of the two vertices inputted. And this is actually done by linear interpolation. On a line, this is actually quite easy. It's a function from dependent on A, B and P, where A and B are vertices and P is a weight factor. This weight factor actually progresses along the line. For example, here at the pixel A it would be 0, and at the pixel B it would be 1, and here at the third pixel in the middle it would be 0.5. So this is kind of like the weight, and it controls how many A and how many B contributes. For example, A in this case would contribute 1 minus P, because, well, if P is 0, which would mean that we are fully on A, 1 minus 0 is 1, so full contribution of A, plus 0 times B, no contribution of B. Other case, take the pixel directly at B, which would mean 1 minus 1 is 0 times A is nothing, plus 1 times B is completely B. And this is actually what is also already calculated back here. And if you take a look and how it would work for the middle, then it would be 1 minus 0.5, which is 0.5a, so the half contribution of a, plus 0.5 times b, half contribution of b, which would mean half b, half a. And actually, you can see I have an example here of colors. So for example, let's imagine a color RGB at the point A of green. So green is totally 1, the rest is 0. And at the point B of red, so red is totally 1 and the rest is 0. Then we would have for the first point A alias green, for the third pixel B alias red, and in between half A half B, which would mean yellow, or 0.5 0.5 0. The thing with lines is, well, of course it can be scaled, it's the same like like points, and it has low computation requirements because we just need a linear interpolation. Of course we need to find this factor B, which is done by the barycentric system of the second order. Barycentric system is a special kind of like coordinate space which you can easily transform in. You can create some formulas, you can create some derivation, you can create an easy equation by using the barycentric system, which takes in the point A, B and the actual pixel P, which needs to be contributed, and it outputs the factor P in this case. So, really easy to use. This is fixed function inside the rasterizer. So there's no program running there. So it will just output all the data and interpolate all the data without no problem. But still a problem here, not good for geometry because, well, we have lines. We will, of course, now could draw an object just by defining lines, but it still is a line. It is still a, let's say, it's still not sufficient for geometry. Well, if you add one point again, we are at a triangle, which is defined by three vertices, a vertice A, B, and C, which is also rasterized by the rasterizer, generating many pixels. And also again, because now we are dependent on three vertices, we need to do a linear interpolation between three points. So a linear interpolation in a triangle, which is not very straightforward. It's actually based on a barycentric system of third order. And we're gonna take a look at the derivation in the next slides, but let me first define all the pros the triangle now have finally reached. So a triangle can be scaled. It has medium computation requirements. It's still more than a pixel, a point, and a line, because now we need to interpolate between three values, and as you will see in the next slide, we have to find three weights with three more complicated functions than on a barycentric system of second order. But the most important thing the triangle brings us, it can describe all closed polygons. So any arbitrary form you can imagine can be described by a triangle with the assumption that the form is closed, so it is not open. So now let's take a look at their derivation. First of all, we have a triangle defined by the points A, B, and C. And we have a point P inside of the triangle where we want to know how much B, A, and C contribute. So the first step is, we just take a look here at B, is to find out how many contribution of B lives at P, and this is actually this here. The length of that line here independent of the total length of all lines from all points is the weight for the contribution of B. So if we expand it to all, we would have three weights, PA, PB, and PC, and the weights depend on the total length of all that contributions and the own contribution. And when we finally put on the equation, we have a blending function dependent on the vertices A, B, and C, and the weights PA, PB, and PC, which is then just a normal linear interpolations. But, well, the challenge is to find that weights. And this is actually done with the barycentric system of the third order. And we have two observations we need to take away from that system. First of all, the equation that PA plus PB plus PC is 1. And the observation that a point P, not in terms of its parameters, but also in terms of its position, can be described by the weight A multiplied by the position of the vertex A, and the same with and the multiplication from the weight of the B with the B vertex, and the same for C. You can take these both things and get an equation out of that and solve that linear system with the Gramscian rules. And it's actually a system with three unknown variables. And so it's actually a matrix system, equation system. And you can solve this with, for example, knowledge from Engineering Mathematics 1 in Germany. If you have that done, you know everything to do that. But, well, even through actually mathematics for engineers is not very easy. It's kind of hard. I can tell it. I've already done mathematics for engineering 1 and 2. And I'm really happy that I have done all that and finished it with all the grades required. So, yeah. And if you solve that, we will not gonna do this here because it's just some hustle we don't need to do because it's all done by the Rathwise. I just want you to understand a bit. We get these equations here. If you're really interested in that, you can take a look here at the links I've put you down here, and you can find some information there. So now let's go on. Let's try to display a quad and create a quad with some primitives. But the thing is a quad actually relevant? Is it required? Are actually primitives with a bigger order than 3 even required? And the answer is, of course, no, I already told you, because you can express every closed polygon as a triangle set. So this is actually a process called triangulation. So you triangulate a polygon, so any object with an order bigger than 3, every polygon with an order bigger of 3, to a triangle. It's no problem. For example, here for a quad, I just draw a line in the middle and, well, there we have it. Of course, quad mesh triangulation is not actually the nicest thing because, well, yeah, quad meshes may be actually less efficient if they are quad meshes and not start defined as triangles. But most of the time, we actually have to live with that because modelers often work with quads. For example, character modeling is completely done with quads, as you can see here, many quads. And yeah, of course, you can create a triangle mesh by just splitting all the quads, but well, they are still quads here. So in this case, for that model, we would need a process called triangulation to create the triangles. So let's just summarize in a bit mathematically expression here, even though the images I've put in here are wrong, because E always have to be 1 and not 0. So yeah, just for you to note down. Let's just describe what we have done until now. First of all, we have some inputs. We had some vertices, 1 up to 3 vertices, and per vertex, k values. Actually, the vertex itself, the position is already one value, but this is more a logical diagram than a kind of like physical information technology right diagram. So yeah. The first step we need to do is we need to take the positions of the input vertices 1 to 3 and rasterize pixels out of that. So we generate in the rasterizer x pixels. The pixel count depends on the screen resolution, the position and the input layout. So are we using points? Are we using lines? Are we using triangles? So these pixels are the first output. We already have the pixels generated, so we know which pixels later on to set. But the next thing we also need is the input of the data per vertex. These data per vertex are merged with the pixels. So kind of like the position of the pixels. We generate the weights and we interpolate the data for each of this k from all ends. And we then got k times x values. And these values are also outputted. These are the right interpolated values that are then in combination with the pixel outputted for further processing. What is the problem which we have until now? The problem is that all objects are overlapping. I told you that all objects are defined on and in relation to the NDS. And this is a problem because now they are all on top of each other. They are all scaled in the same scaling, I mean an object which is far back should be smaller, but this is not done here for now, because, well, it is totally wrong, because it is still in the NDS space, or in relation to NDS. And next problem, all pixels, they have interpolated values, and we have positions, which pixels to set, but we have not finally computed what the color of the pixel is. So this also needs further processing. And this is actually now where the pixel and the vertex shader comes in place. Let me take a look at here from top to bottom. First of all, the input assembler. We have not talked too much about it, because we've just said that there are magically some vertices coming. Actually, the input assembler defines how the data is coming in. So the input assembler knows, okay, I have the following vertices and also how the vertices are laid out and what are the parameters of the vertices, or the layout of the parameters of the vertices, and it knows how many vertices he has. And the most important thing, it knows how to interpret these vertices. So should they be interpreted as a list of triangles, normal triangles, triangle stripes, line lists, points, point lists. There are so many special types we're going to talk about in a few videos. It knows how the input layout is and it knows the vertices. What then the input assembler does, it just takes one vertice at a time and output it is it's through the vertex shader. The vertex shader is a user application which gets as input all the vertex data, which we also defined. And it then operates like the user has programmed it, like we have programmed it, on that vertex data and outputs the vertex data back to the rasterizer. The rasterizer waits until it gets one finished primitive, so point, line or triangle, and then generates the pixel and interpolates the pixel data. After that, it outputs all the pixel data to the pixel shader. The pixel shader can now finally compute with a user application, compute the data or the color of the pixel, which is then returned to the output merger. And the responsibility of the output merger is to draw the pixel on the right render target and also to merge it with the currently existing data, which is inside the pixel, because, well, maybe there was already something drawn on that pixel, so I then need to take a look, for example, for depth values. I can take a look and see, okay, am I allowed to write this pixel, or if there is already a color, do I need some planning, do I need to compute these two pixels together, though that they getting the right color. So there are some steps required there. For example, in the input assembler, I would have that triangle, which is in relation to NDS, so fully covers the screen. After passing the vertex shader, it would look like this, for example, so it has been moved into place. Then the pixel shader would run, or the rasterizer would run, would determine which pixels to draw. The pixel shader would run and say, okay, let's draw a red triangle. And then the output merger would merge it on the already drawn circle and box here. So, well, after the output merger, the target would look like this. Our not so colorful full screen triangle has been converted to a right dimensions and the right color by using all that stages we have described until now. This is actually basically how it works. But now let's take a look at a bit more parts of the pipeline. First of all, we're gonna take a deep look inside the input parameters for the input assembler. As I told you, the input assembler knows how the data is presented, how the vertices are presented, but we're gonna take a look at how they are really presented by taking a look at vertex and index buffers. So then we take a look at what can happen between the vertex shader and the rasterizer, because there is something that can be done there, also controlled by you. We're going to take a look at this also, but not very in depth. And then we also have the render target view and dev stencil view. I will tell you what the render target view is now, because I already told you a few seconds ago about the output merger. The output merger, as I told you, compares the currently generated pixel to the already drawn pixel on the render target. So the render target view is just a description for the output merger to tell the output merger how the final render target looks like. So it tells the output merger, oh, the render target has the following color channels, it has the following width and following size, and so the output merger can access the proper texture and see, okay, this is what the current value looks, and well, so I write out that. Dev stencil view is kind of a different thing because, well, even through the display space doesn't have any kind of like third coordinate, it's just two-dimensional, it still handles the last coordinate, the dev value. And the dev value, also called z value, because x, y, z, is handled specifically because there is a so-called dev buffer, And the def buffer is just the storage for these Z values. And you can actually parameterize the output merger that it rejects or accepts pixel based on the already written value inside of that storage, inside of that depth texture. And even through, you can also tell the output merger to also write to the depth texture. There's also a thing called depth stenciling, but I will talk more about it in another video. So, well, let's take a look at vertex and index buffers. First of all, vertex buffers. I already told you that vertices are just random, or not random, but user-defined data in memory. And so the vertex buffer is just a list of vertices in memory. So just a default buffer. But the vertex buffer view actually, in combination with the pipeline state, tells the GPU how to interpret the data. So in this case, the view would tell the GPU, hey, it is a triangle, in this case, triangle ABC. And the triangle is made of a two-dimensional position here, so -1, -1, 0, 1, -1, and -1, and a color, a three-component color, RGB in this case. So it just tells how the layout is. Layout is described actually not completely in the view, also in the pipeline state, but just for you to get the point. But now the question is, how would I describe a quad? Well, it's just easy. I describe two triangles, the triangle ABC and the triangle DEF. But we now have a problem because we have two overlapping vertices. So the values of B are the same than the values of D, and the values of C are the same than the value of F. So this is a duplication, and duplication is always bad because we are consuming memory. And we don't want to use too many memory. And even if you imagine this character mesh I showed you, nearly every vertex is used four times in this case. Or actually, if we go with triangulation, it would be used eight times. So a vertex used eight times, so eight times the same vertex in memory. It's just really bad. So you would have a file which is eight times bigger than it is required. And you would consume GPU memory that is eight times bigger than required. And this is really bad. And this is where index buffers come into place. So first of all, the vertex buffer has a different layout when you use an index buffer. The vertex buffer is now, when you're using an index buffer, just a list of unbound vertices. So you just store every vertex once inside the vertex buffer. It's unbound. It doesn't even have to care if it is a primitive of type points, or a primitive of type lines, or a primitive type of triangles. You don't care. It's just important in the index buffer, because the index buffer is now the buffer which defines which vertices may made up a triangle, or for example also line or points. So for example, in the case of triangles, the index buffer would define that one triangle is based on 0, 1, 2, which would mean ABC. Next triangle would be based on 1, 3, 2, which mean BDC in this case. So it's just an index inside the vertex buffer which tells the GPU which vertices to use in case it is drawing a triangle. So the GPU would walk the index buffer and would then load the data from the vertex buffer, which will save you memory. Of course, indices also take memory, but it is way less if you're just using an index, because the index is a 32-bit integer, and a vertex can be, for example, if you have a position which is already 3 times 32-bit, which is already 3 times as big as an index. So as you can see, already with just position, index buffers are already rentable. There are some special cases, for example, for quads, you can draw them with just 4 vertices without using an index buffer, but we're going to talk about that in a later video. So yeah, let's just go on. So just to summarize, index into vertex buffer, done. Saves memory, easy. Next thing is tessellation. Tessellation evolves around the Hulse shader, tessellator, and domain shader. The goal is the same like with the index buffer. It is to save bandwidth and to save memory. And also the main thing is actually most of the time bandwidth. Because let's just imagine you want to draw geometry, really dense geometry. The problem is you would actually need all that memory for the dense geometry, but maybe it is not even required to use all that memory, because it may be easy to just store the edges. For example, if you have kind of like an ocean, the ocean by itself is really flat, but only if you have some waves going on there and some water flow and stuff, you would actually need to model the data. And if you want to generate that the data dynamically, this is also a problem. So it would be quite easy to actually describe the movement of an ocean in a function, for example, or in many functions, which are then dynamically used to offset the geometry. So in this case, tessellation comes handy because you just define a coarse bounding box of the water. In this case, it's done by a triangle. This happens as an input. So as an input, you would get here this triangle, which would then be sent as a whole triangle to the hull shader. The hull shader would now see, okay, this is a triangle, and would then configure the tessellator. So I would tell them, okay, let's make out of this edge, and this edge every time 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 edges. So do 5, 5, and 5 on the edges. Then the hull shader would pass that triangle and all that information to the tessellator. The tessellator would now split that edge here into several edges and generate all the required triangles according to a pattern which can be set. And would then, tessellator's fixed function, would then output it again to a new shader, the domain shader. And the domain shader would then run for every new generated vertex and would then be used to actually offset, for example, in the terms of water rendering or ocean rendering, would evaluate for each vertex the kind of like function of the current water movement and then move the vertices up or down, for example. This is how tessellation works. We're gonna make some videos that are explicitly for tessellation here in the future, but for now it's just a short summary. So let's take a look at geometry shader. First of all, the geometry shader is kind of like similar to the tessellation, but it has some things that is doing different. First of all, you could call it software tessellation because the tessellation will not be done automatically. You just have one single X input, one primitive, a point, a line, a triangle, whatever, and you can expand it to N, so a primitive count of your choice and also primitive type of your choice. The difference between the tessellation is that the geometry shader does not generate the new vertices automatically. You have to manually write a program that outputs the data, but this also means that you're more flexible. For example, you could take in a point and generate a quad by using two triangles. This would not be able to do on the tessellator. Because, yeah, okay, you could, on the tessellator, you could put in four points and generate triangles, but it would not be thing you want to do. So you just have one point which just takes one vertice as a memory requirement and then use the computation power of the GPU to actually generate four vertices. So you just save bandwidth and memory and calculate the values on the fly. Would work, for example, if you're drawing a star in the sky, you would just specify the middle point and then you would generate out of that point the quad and use that to draw it. So yeah. If you're drawing many stars, like let's say 100 stars, and the quads are actually not very big and very small, that would be actually more efficient to do it like that. So you would just define positions and go for it. Yeah, we still have some parts of the pipeline which we have not discussed, which is the stream output. I will explain this very, very shortly. I need to explain it because I will also be part of the descriptor we are going to take a look at next video. So yeah, just a short description. Stream output is the possibility to output the generated data inside to a buffer. So for example, if you want to do some physics calculation based on your ocean rendering, you could, after the ocean passed the domain shader stage, you could output the data to a buffer with the stream output, so that you can later use a compute job to do some physics calculation on that, for example. Just a very short description. Yeah, actually we need to talk about some more things, and this is the multiple pipelines, because today the GPU is not only the graphic pipeline. We have two more pipelines to go with. One is the compute pipeline, even though it is not a real pipeline, it's actually just a shader which is once invocated. So yeah, it still exists in here and it's also called a pipeline and pipeline state, but it's just to simplificate things. It's actually not a real pipeline, as you can see. It's just one program that runs and uses no of that specific hardware. Next thing, or new thing, relatively new thing, is the mesh shader pipeline. The difference between mesh shading and normal shading is that you replace all that stuff. So the geometry shader, the tessellation, the vertex shader, and the input assembler is completely deleted in the mesh shading pipeline, and it is replaced with one mesh shader. Actually, the mesh shader consists of two shaders, but mesh shading is an advanced topic we may go into in the future. And the nice thing at mesh shaders is you can choose any data you want as an input. You wouldn't need data at all, and you would then generate triangles with indexes inside the mesh shader and outputted them to the rasterizer. So you skip all that other stuff and output it. Actually, this is more like the GPU works. It's more simid than the thing we have seen before, because, well, the other thing is something which has grown historical, and this is the kind of like new approach which I suspect in 5 to 10 years will only be using this. But for now, we are still on the old pipeline and you still need the information, so we're gonna go the old way here. So yeah, that's it for today. In the next video, we're gonna talk about how this is described in DirectX 12. So see you in the next video. I hope you enjoyed it, and bye. We'll be right back.